Alaska along one of the world's great little railways.
Athens, city of light, freedom, and democracy. Here, as anywhere, tourists don't come to find reality. They come wishing for illusion. They find it in places like this, the Plaka. This isn't real Greece, it's an illusion made for tourists. But it's fast becoming the real Greece for many. What used to be an affair of the heart is now an affair of the pocket. It's even changing the nature of the real Greece. The Greece that existed before the tourists. The Parthenon. To most of us, a symbol of it all. Standing there on the Acropolis, plundered and broken, but still magical. Belief in beauty, scale, and reason. In the summer, Athens is a dirty hothouse, sweltering under a blanket of pollution. The air is sticky, the famed Attic light a dull haze, the sun an indistinct glow. A city so unpleasant that even the Greek government is worried about the image it presents to the world. And yet, each year, the city is the goal of millions of people from all over the world. What do they seek? What relation does modern Greece have to its glorious and seemingly ever-present past? Is today's Athens the inevitable future for all of this small country? This is a journey into the Greek present. Each summer, Greece fills with Western youth. Here at the station for the Peloponnesian Railway, they come to escape Athens into an older world, a world they think is more simple and less in doubt than their own troubled civilization.
We'd like to go to Mykines.
Yes, the next train leaves 12 o'clock.
Sounds banal, doesn't it?
Yeah.
But yes, you can take a train to Agamemnon's throne of blood. Our journey will take us to Mycenae and on through the beautiful mountains of the Peloponnese to end at Olympia, whose ancient games gave glory to Greece and an ideal to mankind.
What's the world's expression? Well, he's a man.
Locals take the train too. Mostly short journeys, visiting a relative in the old village, bringing grandmother back from a marriage or a funeral, taking a case of evaporated milk to the cafe in the hills, Hardly the stuff of great journeys. This is a local train, and its tales are of local life. The first hour takes us through the Athenian suburbs and follows the ancient sacred way to Elefsis. Before the war, you could walk this through open fields like the pilgrims of old. But today, the train passes through a desolation of quarries and cement works, in the shadow of whose smoke a few farmers still scratch a living from a dying soil. And this was the landscape which Henry Miller thought the most satisfactory, the most wondrous that our earth has to offer. Elefsis. The name means happy arrival. There are a lot of truly wonderful things you can see in Greece, said the early travel writer Pausanias. But there is a unique divinity about the mysteries of Elefsis. Here, at the end of the sacred way, mankind first attempted to instill a worldwide respect for human values and nature. Life, it was said, would be unlivable for the Greeks if Elefsis ceased to exist. Here, for 2,000 years, longer than Christianity has existed, thousands of people came each year to be initiated into a mystery which made them better and happier. At the climax of the ceremonies, you were plunged into darkness and then restored to light. Poor Elefsis. Now the shattered fragments of her marble are rotting. One of the most polluted places on earth. She can no longer see the sun. The Greeks believed this once fertile plain of Elefsis was where the gods first bestowed cultivation on mankind. Even in the 30s, there used to be two harvests gathered here each year. If the inroads of industry continue, there will soon be no harvest at all. Tourists don't get off at Elefsis. The little train clatters on, hugging the Straits of Salamis. Here, a Greek fleet defeated the might of the Persian Empire. Now, the wine-dark sea is a toxic swamp where thousands of tons of poison are dumped every day. Would the heroes of old have found it possible to believe what their heirs have done in the name of progress? The Corinth Canal, cut through the Isthmus in 1893. Over it, and we're in the Peloponnese, the rugged peninsula which forms the southern tip of mainland Greece. As the mountains of the Peloponnese rise in front of us, the landscape starts to change. We're entering the harsh, stony hills of the Argolid. Next stop, Mycenae. You get off at a tiny rail halt in a wide valley. Forgotten for millennia, Mycenae is now on everyone's itinerary, although only a handful come by train. The tourist's goal lies up the valley, where the shepherds drive their flocks. The ancient citadel coiled on its brown hill like a dead monster. Come here in the winter or spring, and you'll find a quiet place where the people live off the land. In the summer, some still go about their business, but increasingly they live off the past. Their lives transformed by the weird rituals of tourism. It's a kind of religion. Curtains closed, TVs and air conditioning on, the worshippers arrive in their coaches to give their money and revere the past.
You belong to me, chat tours, a lady did not tie.
They set up these original side stones. They participated to the war of Troy under the leadership of the famous Agamemnon, king of Mycenae. You must know.
Hey, now that's super duper.
The body shape for it. I don't know.
These are so regular, it's hard to believe that.
These stones, if they could speak, would tell a tale. The ancient legends told of the lion of Mycenae, Agamemnon, who sprang from the bosom of the wooden horse of Troy. They told of a stronghold of the Furies, a place of blood, of murder and matricide and primal eldest curses. And here, a century ago, Heinrich Schliemann found the gold-clad bodies of Bronze Age kings whose treasures seized the imagination of the world. And now, film wrappers litter the bath where Agamemnon died. In the morning, we cross the wide olive groves of the Argive Plain. In the distance, the great Byzantine fortress at Argos itself. Many of the tourists get off at Argos for the nearby beaches of Tolon and Mele, leaving mainly locals as the train turns into the central mountains of the Peloponnese. Climb up by a series of great curves, up into wooded heights, broken by gullies and deep watercourses still flowing in summer. And then we reach a lovely mountain village, straddling the track on a sweeping hillside. Parthenion. Here is the life which has been lived in the Mediterranean since time immemorial, a life which has ignored the rise and fall of civilizations, an ancient toil rooted in the rhythm beaten on the earth by forgotten feet. Here women do much of the work while the men talk in cafes. In traditional Greece, the sexes are separate in their roles and in their society. Beyond Parthenion, the line descends into the center of the Peloponnese, where the plain of Tripolis stretches out before you, flat and fertile like an inland sea. In full summer, the green dazzles the eye. We climb out of the plain southwards onto a bare upland, crossed only by a single track, and that often washed away. A land of few villages, high desolation. From the top, a tornado of pollution marks Megalopolis, one of the big cities of the central Peloponnese, a dismal city of the plain. Jerry-built, an ugly town overlooked by a worse ugliness, whose effluent comes down in coloured rain. Megalopolis has grown apace in the last 10 years, people crowding in from the rural villages. The city will follow you, wrote Cavafy, the greatest modern Greek poet. As you have destroyed your life here in this little corner, you have ruined it in the entire world. At Megalopolis, we board the train again to cross the final range of mountains between us and the rich plain of the southern Peloponnese. This lady has come back from the city from seeing her son. He's living like a king, you know, it's not right. Never mind, says her friend. Let him be. You only live once. He's young. Our next stop is a little village spread over hills at the top of a magnificent gorge from which you can see the sea 20 miles off. It's called Krani. Krani is typical mountain Greece, where the Orthodox Church is still a pillar of the community, where the old are the mainstay of the population, where the young go as soon as they can, leaving life to go on, but gradually diminished. Life revolves around the railway in Krani. The track is the main street. The cafes and houses line it. And when the people take their evening walk, the Volta, they stroll up and down the rails themselves.
Most of people of the village, we use the train. Because the train, it's very handy for us. Anytime you want to go to Athens, to Megalopolis, to Tripolis, all of us got transport. 6-7 trains a day, which they help us very, very much. Krani, it's a happy people. Special, well, have a few glass of wine, you really join yourself. They singing, they drinking, sometimes they dancing, because they are happy. After all day working, they come to the shop night time, they meet each other, they sit down, have something to eat, and after they start to drink, and after they start to sing, they quite very, very happy. Most of the people there, they spend most of the time with the farms. Some of the people, they work in the factory down in Megalopolis. Nobody stay home, especially husband, always go to work hard, because I've been working hard myself, and I always respect the husbands, the men. But, they don't have very, very much worries. You know how the Greeks, they don't worry very much. But I can say, if the weather is good, most of them, they go to working. If the weather is bad, we stay in the shop, we have a bit drinking, we have a bit cards, we have a bit yapping, and just pass our time.
That's Tassos Nikolakopoulos speaking. He spent over 20 years catering in Australia, but came back to his native turf to marry a local girl from the next village.
The priest is a good person. He's a great man, not only in the church, but in the public life. And I always respect him, and I say he's a good man. He always comes sit down, have a drink, a bit yapping, and he's grateful to be talking with you. Only thing he does, priest, he don't play any cards. He's a gangster to the game.
Tassos is a man of standing in Krani. He gave the new church its clock. And he's anxious to make life seem as good as he can. But when the men met and talked in the evening, and only the men meet in this fashion socially in village Greece, their talk revealed the underlying anxiety which plagues much of rural and island Greece as they lose their young to the big cities in Greece and abroad. Soon, rural Greece will be a land for the old.
Αυτό εγκαταλείπει το χωριό και αντί να μην φεύγουν οι άνθρωποι, πάνε δουλεύουν όπως το έργο στη Μεγαλόπολη και παίρνουν την οικογένειά τους, πάνε τα παιδιά τους μαζί για να πάνε στο σχολείο να πάνε να μάθουν γράμματα.
Σωστά.
Εδώ πέρα δεν εξυπηρετούμε.
Σωστά. Well, I say one thing here. The father, he was talking to me. He say the young people, they can't stay here because they are not satisfied with the jobs. We haven't got any jobs here. And people, they have to send the boys to the school. We haven't got the great school, like the high school and something like that. For this why he reckon the village is going to get smaller, not bigger. Like we've got a young man here, and he can't get any job. That's something make him to go somewhere to work in. Well, if he can't get a job in this village, he will go somewhere further. He go to the city, Athens, Tripoli, Kalamata, or other go overseas. He's got to build him up himself. He's going to work in, to live in.
Now, what do you say, Theothoraki? Do you want to stay in Greece or to leave? I want to leave. Why? Because, well, you know the reason. Because of the work.
Κατ' άλλον τρόπον, διότι δεν έχουν χρήματα. Αν έχουν χρήματα, εξυπηρετούνται. Το χρήμα εκείνο είναι που εξυπηρετεί τον άνθρωπο.
Εντάξει, ο καθένας κοιτάει να δεν πώς έχει. Να τη βολέψει καλύτερα, ας πούμε.
Έτσι. Δηλαδή, αυτή είναι η κατάσταση η σημερινή. Να
πολλά.
Με συγχωρείτε, κύριε. Αυτή είναι η κατάσταση σημερινή. Εδώ στα χωριά και για αυτό το ρήμαξαν. Δεν πάει νέος κανένας, κύριε.
Well, his gentleman here, he's reckon, well, he's a bit lazy. The young generation, they got to get the money, they got to get 50 and they got to spend 200. They don't want to go any jobs. They are not interested. Only all they want to go to the city. What they do the city? They want to get, say, plying wages just to live. And they expected from the old people to send them whatever they got. For this why the young generation, they haven't got any interest in the future.
How can you say there's no unhappiness here? If all the young people go away, who will tend the sheep? Old people have problems of age. One limps, one has a bad back, or his head hurts. Who will do the work when all the young have gone?
Μπροστά τους μιλάω, αν έχουν κάτι απόθεμα. Ό,τι παίρνουν και ζουν. Και είναι και χρεωμένοι, θα σου πω.
It's all right for you, Tassos. You went abroad to earn all your money. Don't blame me. I just showed a bit of enterprise. That's how things are in life. Thousands of people have gone away from these parts. People have been leaving villages since before Christ was born. It's 6 o'clock in the morning. When the train leaves Krani, it careers hundreds of feet down the mountain on a great switchback. Crossing rickety bridges and yawning drops, branches rattling the roof and dashing the face as the traveller leans out. And then suddenly the line flattens out, and there a wonderful vista, the whole lush plain of Messini stretches out before you, rimmed by mountains, sea flat and sea fertile. After what has gone before, this is a third Greece, fecund and ripe, overflowing with figs, oranges and lemons. Zevgalatio. Our train goes on to the deep south at Kalamata, but we'll get off here to take a connection to the western seaboard. Here, away from the eyes of foreigners, live the gypsies, horse traders and tinkers. Wherever I travel in it, said George Seferis, Greece keeps wounding me. We change trains to go west. This diesel is a kind of intercity going up to the big port of Patras. The line goes through a gap in the western mountains, an immemorial route for travellers. After mile of empty beaches. This is not the Greece of the tourists. We stop at Kaiapha, a grove of plane trees behind sand dunes. Here, Greeks come at the weekends to bathe. There's nothing here but a cafe in the railway line. But through the trees, three grand old buildings stand in peaceful isolation. They stand along a causeway on an island between the sea and the mountains. They look like hotels, and in a way they are. People do stay here, but they're all Greeks. And they're all old. They rise in the late afternoon, come and take the air, and sit and talk. The women knit and chatter of the things that old women always do, especially of their youth and of today's young. These women are knitting a bedspread for a young couple's wedding. They make a joke about sex. He is wishing all blessings on the young man who sleeps beneath this. Ah, the young, they know so little. Why is it you only see clearly when you're old and spent? At the end of the island, behind the hostels, is a little church. Inside, the stately presence of the Byzantine tradition. The fragrance of incense. On the altars, wax models of afflicted limbs. The old people have come here to rejuvenate their bodies. Each day at dawn, they rise and go down to the lake, and there a ferry comes to take them. They will sail across the lake and enter the mountain to take its healing springs. Like the ancient myth in reverse, they pay the ferryman to help them find their lost youth. A ritual as old as Greece itself, but ironically, the Greek government will soon take this place away from their old people and give it to the tourists. We leave Pyrgos on the final stage to Olympia.
Quedó
last few miles of the journey are an exhilarating dash on a one-horse coach up the wide, beautiful valley of the River Alfeios. The Greek name for this place was Arcadia, and that name has stuck ever since as a name for an ideal landscape. Green even in the height of summer. Olympia Station, the end of the line. If you walk to the very end of the line, past the buffers, and look over the fence, the valley stretches before you with the smell of pine resin on the warm wind. Thankfully, they didn't push the railway any further and left the valley in its Arcadian tranquility. But round the corner, your reverie is broken. Modern Olympia is like the Athens Plaka in miniature. The tourists pour in their coaches for a day and a night to spend their money in knick-knack shops and in chic boutiques and to dance in discos and eat in self-service cafes. To what reality should Greece pay heed? To this future or to this past? The sanctuary lies beyond the modern town. Here for 1,000 years the warring Greeks shelved their differences and held their games in a spirit of peace, with an ideal of man's physical, intellectual and moral potential. Does the past have any relation to the present? Do the values of the past have any meaning for today's generations? Time will tell. The ancients believed that in the grace of the gods there is a kind of compulsion, and that in the end they force their wisdom on us. And then we start all over again.